Part of the world, there are men and women who choose the path of least resistance, who accept lives of fear and isolation. But we will respond to death with life. We will respond to the nightmare with the dream. We will fight and imagine.
In my view, corporate rule is dictatorship, and the denial of shaping an economy is an end of democracy.
Night, and that corporations were threatening to further erode our sovereignty. make it impossible for our children to experience true freedom, we rise up and we say no.
Separation is a device used against you to tell you who you should and should not talk with, fraternize with, be friends with. You have a choice. You have a choice to be a union, to be one voice, to be a people.
We are the anti-WTO. Yes. People before profit.
People before
before profit and before all things, life, 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 life,
people here from all over. You got labor, you got environmentalists, you got teachers, you've got children, you've got coalitions between people of color and you know, mainstream white Americans. You've got middle class, you got working poor, you got poor, you got everybody out here because this hurts people. This is bad for people. It's bad for our jobs here. It's bad for the people over there.
It's about their future being traded off by corporations who frankly don't give a shit what happens to them. That's what it's about. That's what people are fed up with. They understand it.
Ladies and gentlemen, a little bit of information. We are successfully blocking out delegates.
We are making available for you to leave now. There are protesters at the end of 6th Avenue on each end of our block, so you'd be let out right in the middle of the protests. I recommend you stay here if you can.
Yes, yes.
The opening session is still postponed. I called and asked for an immediate update.
They said, to relax, put your feet up, go to your hotel room, relax, have lunch, or until the situation is safer out there.
I would stay
you
here.
Cannot get to the, you cannot get to the Paramount. You cannot get to the Paramount.
I think the beautiful thing about it was there was no mastermind. What there was an invitation to join hands. And the joining of hands happened because everyone knew you have to hold your hands and hold each other's hands, otherwise we're not going to make a difference. Each of us is too tiny. Each of us is only be addressing a tiny piece of this giant problem. And until we join hands, we're not even going to start to begin to address it. But if we join hands, we can totally surround it. And that physically, literally, as well as symbolically, is what happened in Seattle.
We changed the landscape physically, but also mentally. Life is very restricted and boxed in. It's hard to break out and be free. So that was one of like the magnificent things about being in Seattle. That day, people didn't feel helpless. That was a moment to not be helpless.
And paint compliance. If you do not move, you will be the subject of pain.
Thank you.
a demonstration of United States. It is a demonstration of all working class people all over the world, rich country, poor country, white country, black country, all countries.
You know, it's difficult because a lot of working class in this country don't make the link that they are linked directly with people and Brazil, that they are linked directly with people in Mexico City. And what happens to those folks happens to them. Not immediately, but damn, it'll happen to them.
They have said it was in countries like mine, Barbados. If you want jobs, you have to forget trade union rights. If you want jobs, you have to forget labor law. If you want jobs, you have to forget decent wages. We have said to hell with you.
We weren't just talking about Seattle. We weren't just talking about Washington State. We weren't just talking about America.
The people united will never be defeated.
It was a world coming together in Seattle and saying, this is what we want. This is what we deserve. This is what we are going to damn demand.
While American business prospers, American workers don't. While American agribusiness prospers, American farmers don't.
It's a stealth government. It's creating a global constitution, protecting property and the interests of big investors over everything else, and especially over the needs of people and their rights.
The economies of local communities and national systems are handed over to global corporations through the coercive rules of the World Bank, IMF, and the World Trade Organization.
All the victories that we had won with the struggle of the civil rights movement, with the working class struggles, have finally been hacked away.
Just trying to put on a rally here at the Memorial Stadium and then march downtown and march back. But the real war, the real point of impact was downtown.
There was a line of marshals that the national leadership of the AFL had, I believe, set up. There's some effort on some elements in the labor movement to do whatever they could to keep people away from the front lines and from supporting those people who are being assaulted by the police. A huge number of rank and file trade unionists and some of the gutsier unions, they walked right through the marshals and joined us on the front lines to hold the police lines back.
You have to kind of embrace a diversity of people as well as a diversity of tactics. If you're 45 and you're working in a factory and you've got a family of four to feed, your tactics and thinking at this protest are going to be a little bit different than if you're, you know, 17 or 18 or 19. Our differences are our strengths. I don't think anybody wants to live in like a homogenous culture. Benefit because we have such a diversity of tactics to have a little bit more dialogue between, say, the people prepared to do civil disobedience, which means they're locked down in a certain position or what have you. They're very vulnerable to force by the authorities. So you can't put them in danger by choosing a tactic that's going to bring down the wrath of the state on people who sort of put themselves in a high risk situation. So for that reason, there needs to be a little bit more awareness of who might be doing what. Not that a statement didn't have, you know, need to be made.
Penny, it is so sad to see all the destruction.
To me, it was a perfect example as to why we need to fight. Because this city got up in arms about them breaking Starbucks' window. You know what I mean? They didn't go out and hurt somebody.
For us to have to close our stores during the peak season, the holiday Christmas season just beginning, really is an injustice.
Everyone, because of the property, downtown Christmas shopping, was up in arms, and to me that exemplifies we're fighting against capitalism. And they'll go to any lengths to protect capitalism.
Display of unruliness and a very difficult day for police.
And I think our officers are exercising remarkable restraint.
It was the actions of the protesters, the demonstrators, that led them to take the actions they did.
There is not one corner of this downtown area that has not fell victim to this destruction.
The protesters vowed to bring anarchy to downtown Seattle for another day.
But the National Guard will be...
We understood why we were out there, and we understood what was going on. So when you went home and looked at TV, you know that was what was being portrayed there was not what really happened if you were out there on the street.
We have not used tear gas, and we will not be using tear gas.
Labor leaders make the decision to steer their march out of downtown, try to keep their parade nonviolent.
They characterized the labor march as the peaceful march, and then everybody else got lumped in with the violence or the other stuff they were so enough.
up in arms about.
Extremely tense situation in downtown Seattle.
Violent protesters.
Threatening demonstrations.
And the way they characterize youth really hurts. When they saw black youth in the streets during WTO, they called them gang members. So I felt that they just played a role in just reinforcing all of the isms that already exist.
The leftover protesters were even fighting among themselves.
No one here blames labor or environmentalists or even Seattle.
Protesters turn on one another.
Our coming together is where our power is, and so it makes sense that they would focus on our differences and divisions.
The mayor urging protesters not to repeat this tomorrow, but no one quite sure what could happen with the WTO and protesters still in town.
While corporations build empires across borders, we are fenced in. We are taught to fear each other, and isolation leaves us powerless. Corporate power can only build its global networks by dividing us. In the new global marketplace, we are cut off from each other and from what we might ourselves become.
We shut down the World Trade Organization yesterday. We're going to keep it shut down to the best of our abilities, acting nonviolently and directly. And we're not going to be intimidated by rubber bullets, by wooden bullets, by tear gas, by martial law.
There was so much fear coming out of Tuesday. We had been shot at. We had been gassed. People had been beaten and shot. People didn't expect that going into Tuesday. And people had to recommit themselves and reaffirm their position.
That night, we ended up meeting up on the corner of Broadway and John and decided about what we were going to do the next day. The next day, we'd meet up at 6:30 at Denny Park, and then we'd try to take back the city. We started to weave our way through the roadblocks that they had set up, and I looked around, I could see people were afraid, and at that point I said, that's really not fear in your gut or in your throat, that's really your first taste of freedom. People were coming out of nowhere. I mean, it was like a scene from that Michael Jackson video, Thriller. People were like coming out of manholes, people were coming out of cars. So we went from like 50 people to like 100 people to like 150 people to like 300 people. And then just the numbers just kept growing. I don't know where all these people came from. And I think the cops were totally surprised by that.
People had come off of Tuesday night, and it was pretty rebellious, and people were unclear about why the suddenly, a very negative and aggressive response by the police and that sort of thing. And And so, like, you know, Wednesday was the defining day from Tuesday night about how people were going to respond.
We are ready. We are ready. Let's give the steel workers a good name this time around.
Fear by a lot of union officials about just the word direct action. It makes it sound too militant.
Unfortunately, big labor these days has a big fat history of really writing itself right out of people's movements.
We had some unions that absolutely wanted to be in the street and wanted to be as aggressive as anybody. And then we had others that thought that it was absolutely ridiculous that we were out there.
Power! 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 Power to the people!
There was an intentional focus to split the coalition. It wasn't just labor doing it on itself. The police pressure, the news, everything wanted to do that.
Power!
Power!
Power! Power to the people!
This is actually supposed to be one of the designated demonstration areas for this whole WTO thing. We're supposed to have that right. It's guaranteed in the Constitution again. The mayor does not have the right to supersede the Constitution, but that's been done here today. I think at that point, all of the national media, international media, were probably showing things, and you know, the city just wanted to get rid of us. We were put on buses and taken to Sandpoint.
We can't win this fight alone. If we're going to be successful in taking on the power brokers, the multinational corporations, right, and all that money, the only way that you can take on global capitalism is with a global movement of people.
While there was this coherence that we are about the same issues,
but we are not about identical issues. Yeah. The rubric is the same, the umbrella is the same, but within each of our movements, we can shape and articulate our freedom while just being fully aware of other people.
And that we all have things in common. It doesn't mean that we're always going to agree on everything, but we cannot allow those little things that we don't agree on to get in the way of the ultimate goal. And the goal is to take back democracy on this planet.
So I'd like to introduce to you David Taylor from Direct Action Network, the people who helped with us shut down the WTO in the streets of Seattle. Direct Action Network that are still out of jail came down today to support you guys. And show them what coalitions are. When labor and students and environmentalists and human rights activists stand together, we can and did shut down the WTO. Keep these coalitions strong, and we want to show the WTO that if we stand together in solidarity, we cannot be stopped. Thank you.
I know if you got a credit card, you're welcome as hell downtown, but if you want to bring your First Amendment rights with you, you're on your way to the pokey. So I want to sing a song about a time-honored American tradition, and that's civil disobedience.
Yeah.
Maybe it was Dorothy Day. Some will say Dr. King and Gandhi set them on their way. No matter who your mentors are, it's pretty plain to see. If you've been to jail for justice, you're in good company. Have you been to jail for justice?
Youngsters who were peacefully demonstrating, who weren't doing a damn thing to hurt anybody, who went down the street, and I watched them jackbooted, helmeted, club-holding. You were treated shabbily. If this was my city, I would apologize to you for that happening in this city. It's... And I want to welcome, this is where you belong, right here with the labor movement.
Then the rally ended, and then there was no march.
Come on down! Come on downtown! Shut it down!
There was such a sense of disappointment at that point that we weren't actually going to challenge this no protest order. So some of us got together and organized a follow-up march, and we went from the pier, climbed the Pike Street hill, climbed there up towards downtown.
Our streets! Our streets! Whose streets? Our streets!
we got to Second Avenue, there was a group of maybe 2,000 people, and they were moving from our left to our right, and it was obvious they were running from something.
Malcolm once said that riot is the voice of the people, you know? This wasn't a riot by any means of the word, but it was a manifestation of the people's voice. And the response by the police department was one of the most significant turning points. It told everybody that all of you are slaves. And you better get back in here.
We had a rally down at the docks, and we went through the Pike Market and came up to the corner and saw those police chasing the kids down the street. These are the same kids that have been marching with us. They weren't doing anything wrong.
People got pissed. And I had trade unionists who, just a matter of days before, were saying we shouldn't be out there, calling me up saying, when are we going to protest next? I want to be there, because what's going on is wrong. And one thing that you got to say about the labor movement, you know, when our sisters and brothers think something's wrong, they will get engaged. Sometimes it takes a while to get there, right? And they, you know, and we all have to connect the dots. But, you know, when they saw people that they had marched with on Tuesday, that they had developed relationships with on Tuesday, being beaten and being gassed, right? That.
State of my country right now. I'm crying because I got pepper gas, but I'd cry anyway. I mean, it
radicalized a lot of people to see that when push came to shove, that they were totally willing, in fact, had a blueprint for making war on their own people.
I have a 7-year-old child. I'm out here to voice my opinions on how we should protect our environment for the future. And I have the right to assemble, and my rights have been taken away today.
They have a letter from Nick Licata, who's a councilman, saying that she is no threat to the public and that she has the right to freely walk the streets in the city of Seattle. And she is showing that to the police now, that Nick Licata says she should be able to walk the streets.
They're telling us is that it's okay for you to protest if you're small in numbers and weak, but once you grow into a mass movement, it's not okay to protest.
Your normal rights don't apply this week in Seattle, apparently.
Why is that?
Because we're winning.
Seattle Mayor Paul Schell was in our King 5.
We are joined by Ray Waldman, the director of the Seattle Host Committee for the WTO.
Police Chief Norm Stamper talked to reporters.
Mayor Paul Schell, the police department defends its methods. Seattle Police Department, right? Pam McCammon joins us on the telephone right now. She is with the Seattle Police Department.
Obviously, we feel that we have handled things very well, even though some people decided to be violent. Still, we have been and done things correctly. We have not made mistakes.
How many civilians were injured?
Less than 20.
A democracy such as ours is tested on a routine basis. Obviously, we are witnessing that here on the streets of Seattle, as certain rights may or may not be taken away due to the situation at hand.
Certainly, in the face of intense provocation, our police officers responded very, very effectively. We too share in the anguish and the pain to see windows boarded up at dozens of businesses.
And you need to help us with that, because if they see themselves being made heroes or victims, then we are sending the wrong messages.
And the cops just started running at us all of a sudden with canisters. I guess it was pepper spray, and just attacking the crowd.
How do you feel right now?
A lot better. I'm pretty calm. My eyes hurt, and I can't really open them without a lot of pain.
Well, good luck, Natalie. Keep your eyes shut. You can't see anything. That's pretty much the story for people who are getting in the way down here.
What can I do?
I would stand on the side of the street and stay out of the way, ma'am.
Anyone who wants to stand down here and be in the way, I guess they're inviting trouble upon themselves.
Police decided on Wednesday night to do what I personally call just hunting people. And they literally pushed them from Pike Place Market down First Avenue. They're out of the no protest zone. They're out of the curfew zone. The curfew had not even happened yet. And here's the police marching down the street, actually hunting them down.
As the police surrounded this group of protesters, and we gave refuge to them in the labor tickets.
Hey, we've talked for 4 days. We'll sit down.
Sit down.
If you're media, please step to the front. If you're not, sit tight.
Okay, we need you to move. Sir, do you have credentials as media?
Independent media.
Do you have credentials? Sit down. Stand up, move around the can, and go across the street to the rest of the crowd. Stand up, walk around, across the street to the rest of the crowd.
What if we don't want to be arrested? We don't want to be arrested.
No, you're not getting
in. May I go this way?
No, you may not. Go.
They just arrested people. And we had people that did nothing but come out of the Labor Temple building and follow the instructions that were given by the police that ended up in jail. So, and at that point, we said enough is enough.
If we wanted to, we could have tore this city apart. There was 50,000 people in the streets yesterday, and a handful of people broke a handful of windows. And now they're taking the peaceful protesters that are out here and treating them really wrong. It's wrong. They should realize that if we wanted to raise hell out here, it could have happened.
From a Cold War militarization that threatened humanity with one blow, we have moved to the militarization of every aspect of life. A militarization that threatens humanity with many blows, in many places, and in many ways. National armies created to defend against foreign enemies are turning their rifles inward. Corporate power depends on armies to protect it, jails to silence dissent, and violence to pave the way for its expansion. National repression is the necessary premise for corporate globalization. Every country, every city, every house, every person, everything is a battleground.
arrested without being charged, and we are being detained here without being charged, and we'd like to speak with our lawyer. We are citizens with voices, and we'd like our voices to be heard. Our constitutional rights have been suspended today.
We had decided on the buses and prior to that in our own affinity groups that, you know, if we were to get arrested, we would not give our name. We would not cooperate in any way. We would not be separated. We would all ask for and make the same demands, which were immediate release, no, all charges to be dropped.
We are not getting off the bus until we have a meeting with our lawyer on the bus.
There were about four other buses that were parked beside us. We're trying to figure out what to do. We're posting messages up against the wall, you know, shouting at each other, trying to pass on messages through the attorneys to figure out what was going on.
So after 14 hours, they decided it was time for us to go. We were told that we'd be moved to King County. So the bus started to move. And we weren't taken to King County. We were taken out of the view of the media. We were taken around the back of Sandpoint, and then we were unloaded. The cops, the riot gear got on, pepper sprayed a few people from the front of the bus. We do something like that on the bus, it goes throughout the bus and everybody gets it. So at that point, we were forcibly taken off of the buses and taken into Sandpoint. And some of us were taken to King County.
People had a strategy about how they were going to deal. They were going to stick together in jail and not let anyone be separated or isolated or intimidated or punished or threatened. And that really worked.
Our director of organizing was one of those arrested. So that's the wrong person you want to get into a jail cell with a bunch of other folks, because he's going to organize the people on the inside. So that's what happened, was that people started organizing on the inside. There was solidarity actions going on, chanting. What was going on outside to show support for them was also happening on the inside.
It was incredibly moving to hear that 6,000 people had come and sat down or locked down for it so we could see our attorneys.
I was told by the ILWU to deliver the message that if this wasn't resolved, that the ILWU was willing to shut down the ports in solidarity.
It was an obligation for us to be out there. We had to be there. It was our role to be there.
It created a sense of community because that was where the steel workers and the other unions were bringing food and blankets and water and taking care of people, and people were just taking care of people in what seemed to be the most natural way for human beings to function, but which we had never really seen before.
And then to hear also from the legal team that people in Cuba and Amsterdam and London and Africa and Mexico were rallying for our release was also quite amazing. That first night, everyone was out there so late, and then they had that spokesperson council, and they had the people talking on the bullhorn, repeat after me, this is what is going on. But what was amazing was that we did make a plan through this whole consensus model with a couple hundred people there. I had never seen anything like that before in my life, and I think that for me that was a turning point. Because I started to look at people around me differently. I think the whole jail experience really brought a lot of people together, because at that point it became very personal.
It was a good experience to be there in jail, to recognize that, hey, no matter where these people are coming from, right, they decided that they had had enough and that they're willing to lay whatever they had at that point, which was their body down for the cause. And to be with a group of people, no matter where you were coming from, was a very powerful thing.
The other thing I have to do tonight,
the other thing I have to do tonight,
tell you some bad news.
Tell you some bad news.
And I want your promise.
And I want your promise.
of us came to Seattle for different reasons. Some of us out of desperation, as much as out of hope. Some of us came with causes we have worked for our whole lives. Some came for reasons we cannot yet articulate. When we filled the streets of Seattle, there was a power in our bodies that we didn't know we had. In this city, for this moment, our lives were our own. Who can say at what precise location and at what exact hour and date this global movement began? In Seattle, we were only a small part of the movement, but in the gas and bullets, our memory returned. For a moment, our history was made clear to us. We felt the edges of our skin marked by a global and historical struggle. We stopped waiting for our world to be legislated or prescribed to us. This time, we did not ask for permission to be free.
We had to do more than just give lip service to this coalition building. If we're going to mount an effective response to the events of the weekend and really coordinate an effective rally on Friday, we had to get out there and walk the talk.
We're going to do this, right? Let's just be perfectly clear. We're going to march back into that no protest zone. The question that the mayor and the chief of police had to ask is, do they want to confront us?
Animal rights, every different type of group of people as affected by this, and that's their worst mistake ever. They kissed off too many people, and now we're going to fight back, and we're going to fight back unified, and that's what's going to help us.
It has to start somewhere. It has to start sometime. What better place than here? What better time than now?
We took the seat back! We took the seat!
They tried to see us at them, and they couldn't stop us.
I think Seattle taught people that all these interests, not only can they live with each other, but they're necessary for each other. That no labor movement will really be strong and sustainable till it includes the environmental concern. And no environmental movement will have a relevance for the future unless it brings into the equation, how do people live? How do they survive? How do they eat? How do they get water?
Was a banner, you know, Teamsters and Turtles together at last. That was so wonderful. Of course, we belong together. The same people who exploit natural resources exploit human resources. We belong together.
This is something that's part of our prophecy, that it's time for us to unite ourselves as common people throughout the world, crossing some of these barriers that have been created by corporations to keep us apart.
Yeah, we got to have solidarity around these things, but solidarity doesn't mean that we don't talk about the issues that separate us. And that's the biggest change that I see happening. Not for us to buy into this, the whole kumbaya, let's sit around a fucking campfire idea and just march down the road together. That's part of it. But you got to take it that step further. Race, class, gender, sexism, heterosexism, the whole nine yards. If that's not in your analysis, then you're only half-stepping, and you're not really working for the revolution.
In order to make a stronger movement, we need to actually stop and say, okay, let's assess ourselves and see what we can do to get to know each other better.
Without being liberal and fake about it, figure out how to work with groups that are in struggle and who've been in struggle, and not like, say, come follow us, but like, oh, we're finally awake. Gee, we're kind of late. Let's get something together here.
I will absolutely never be the same again. I've never seen this before. I've never seen people stand up like this before. And I'm going to take this home, and this is going to keep me going for a long time, because it's really opened my eyes to some amazing possibilities.
We need to then make the circle full and not rest satisfied that the streets of Seattle were fully global, because they will not be fully global till the streets of Delhi and Trivandrum and Ghana and in South Africa and in Bangkok and in Latin America, we start to have the same expressions of solidarity and the same sense and build up that we are together in this.
Isn't this extraordinary? I've been around since the 60s and my dad in the 30s with the UAW, and this is really happening for the first time. It's great.
I am reading this off my paper.
misinformation.
A complete collapse.
A complete collapse.
There will be no new millennium round.
Not only will there be attempts from the Pat Buchanans, there will be an attempt from the Democrats and from the Republicans to ensure that the anti-globalization movement ends up looking like and being a xenophobic movement in its most obvious articulation. And I think we have to ensure that that does not happen, because the anti-globalization movement is about a universal shared humanity.
We scared the shit out of them in Seattle. It's absolutely not, you know, they will set back now they've had time to reflect, and they're going to try to spin it different ways. But let me tell you, Secretary General Michael Moore is talking different about global trade today than he was just 2 weeks before.
It's time that we come together. It's time to stop feeling as though we are isolated entities living lives of unsatisfactory consumption. It's that we can do it.
We have the capacity to remobilize and come together again, and that's good, because we will.